And you'll find that they can only make you happy for so long. You will look for this person to spend your life with. And that person, if they're not going the way that your heart truly desires, they're only going to fulfill you for so long. You can obtain assets. You can obtain money. You can obtain homes. You can obtain a quality education. Thank God for all of these things that God has given us the freedom to go after. But if he's left out of the equation, what have you really gained? What is the net profit? A net profit is this. You have assets here, anything that you gain, and then anything that has to be taken away after that, and whatever remains, that's your net. That's your net profit. So if you make $600 and they take $150 for taxes, your net gain for your check, for your works, is $450. That's your net. So anything that you're going to get in life, there has to be a removal process before you can obtain anything. Even if you go after the things of the world, there's going to be a cost. And if you're going to go after the Lord and the very best that the Lord has for you in your life, there's going to be a cost. So you might as well just say, God, whatever. You might as well just say it, because there's no other way around blessing. And there's no other way around cursing. If you're going to choose to reject the truth and go to a devil's hell, you better know that you're going to have to go fighting, you're going to have to go kicking, because the Spirit of God will deal with you. The Spirit of God will talk to you. The Spirit of God will give you dreams. The Spirit of God will put people in your pathway, remind you of the way you're supposed to go. The Spirit of God will give you a hardship to remind you it's time to pray. The Spirit of God will have some of your best friends desert you so you'll remember to remind you that he is your best friend and remind you that he will never leave or forsake you. So David is speaking from experience when he talks about an individual who will love anybody and will use anybody but wants to be loved by someone and everyone. And his love is universally available to everyone. So no matter what stage you're in your life, you have to understand, first of all, that God is here. And God is in your life. But in order for him to have full residence, in order for him to live within, there has to be this. There has to be a spiritual relationship, which is point number one. There has to be a private relationship. So the psalmist here, David, is telling us point number one. He says, we're blessed. Why? Because we have a personal relationship. The blessed man is, first of all, a devout man. Now, what does the word devout mean? The word devout means that this is an individual who is able to take the word of God. This is why Psalms verse 2 is so important, because the devout man is the one who is able to take the truth of the gospel and not try to change it into a fable. He will not change it into a lie. He will not try to dissect. He will not try to come to a conclusion of what the word is saying without God's guidance. He's not going to try to figure out the conclusion of the matter without asking God first. So that's the first point, number one. There has to be a private relationship, and that private relationship is based on you being devout to God. In Acts 8 and 2, at the time that after Stephen was killed, after Stephen was stoned, understand that there were devout men, there were Jews who were devout. Why? Because they were holy men of God, and they were hurt, they were brokenhearted over the loss of the brother Stephen to the body of believers. But these were men that did not participate in the assassination. However, there were other men who called themselves religious that were part of the assassination process of Jesus Christ. They called themselves legal. They called themselves scriptural. They called themselves priests. They called themselves scribes. They called themselves holy and righteous men. Why? Oh, yes, I tithe twice a week. Oh, yes, I tithe. Oh, yes, I fasted twice a week. Oh, yes, I opened the doors to the synagogue. And yes, I know the law. I know the Mosaic law. I know there's 613 laws. And I know the 613 laws take us down to 10 commandments. And I know the 10 commandments take us down to 2, which is love God and love your neighbor as yourself. I know all of that. But Jesus was letting them know, listen, if you are not part of the spiritual tree, you are disrespectful and you are you are branches that have to be cut off. Matthew 15 and 13. So he says, there's no honor in you. You can know the Bible back and forth. You can be a walking thesaurus of a Bible. You can be a walking Britannica of a Bible. You can be a walking internet of the Bible. You can preach the Bible up and down, Greek, Hebrew, Spanish, Russian. You can preach it in so many different dialects. You can preach it in Egyptian. You can preach it in English. You can preach it in so many different languages. But unless the language that you have in your heart is one that takes you to the cross at a time when you are challenged with sin, you have no relationship with God. That's the word of God. This is why David put such an emphasis, this is why he put such a focus on us being blessed. He's letting us know, first of all, that the man is that the blessed man is a devout man. And then he tells us that a blessed man doesn't initiate a test. What do you mean by that, Brother Mark? We don't stand in the way of sinners. We don't walk the pathway that sinners try to entice you to walk. See, the problem is this. Every saint is going to be tested. Yes. The question becomes, who is doing the testing? If it's a test from God, it is a test that is designed to promote you and bring you to a place of greater prominence. It is a test that is designed based upon the fact that God can refer you. In 1611, when the King James Version of the Bible was created, understand that that word test was taken as a word that meant to try. It did not mean to entice someone. The word of God tells us not to entice the Lord thy God. But here we see where a man is tested and he is not initiating the test. The righteous man doesn't know when a test is coming. The righteous man just simply wants to be prepared, or as Sister April was saying earlier, the righteous man wants to be in a place of full equipment, so when the test comes, they will have the mettle to stand and withstand the test. But the true man of God does not put himself in a situation where he's going to be deliberately weakened by something, or he is going to stand in the way of something that he knows will bring him to a place of downfall. Because too many people in the body of Christ today are taking circumstances that have happened in their past, they're taking hurts that they have experienced in the past, and what they're doing is they're allowing them to cloud, and they're allowing them to make murky, and they're allowing them to make bleak their relationship with God. They're using these circumstances, these hurts and these pains, they're not addressing them at the cross. They're trying to work in spite of them, and as a result, what they're doing, they're using those methods of hurt as a way to go out and do what they want to do, and then say, see, there's nothing that's happened to me, so therefore I must be a child of God. The word of God says we will not walk in the congregation of the unrighteous. That's a command. That's not just a wish. It's letting us know that we have a decision to make if we're going to call ourselves a disciple. A disciple is what? A disciple is a person who is determined to follow the leader. So if this young man says to me, I want to take you to Magic Mountain, and he has the map to get me to Magic Mountain, and I've never been to Magic Mountain, I've got to become his disciple in order to get to the destination. He knows where to go and I don't. But so often, God is given the keys to the car. So often, God is asked to be the cab driver, but we will tell him just as quickly as we ask him for direction, now you scoot over. So often in life, I'm not indicting anybody. I'm talking about a general approach that has to change in order for God to be better glorified and in order for us to be in a place of serviceability for the kingdom of God. That's what I'm alluding to here. I'm saying that in order for us to be the things that God wants us to be, we've got to be able to come to a decision. If something has happened that's been traumatic in our life, we have to come to the decision that, yes, this has happened, and I'm willing, Father God, to give it to you. Some people have never, ever, 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 ever released in their spirit the fact that God has taken someone close to them. They've never forgiven God. Maybe something happened that you weren't even aware of, and you have never given yourself an opportunity to release God. And God is saying, I can't release my best unto you until you release your hurt to me. And what it ends up doing, it ends up working, watch this, it ends up working like the chaff that he speaks about in the fourth verse. He says that the ungodly are not like the righteous man. Why? Because they're like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Well, how does the chaff work? The chaff work according to Matthew chapter 4, or Mark 4 and 18. Mark 4 and 18 tells us that those people who are like the chaff are the ones that will sit in a congregation, they will hear the word of God. It sounds good to them. It emotionally arouses them. It piques their curiosity. They get to a place where they want to be gung-ho and set the world on fire for the Lord. But the moment something happens, the moment persecution hits, the moment tribulation arises, the moment somebody takes their lollipop, they want to turn in their ministerial license. So this is what happens when we don't let God address and refine. That is what this process is all about. It's about refinement. But in order to be refined, sometimes you have to be pinned down. Sometimes you have to be held down. Sometimes you have to be locked down. And you have to be conveyed into the fire. And once you get conveyed into the fire, you begin to see resources emerge that you weren't even aware that you were equipped with. You begin to see prayer resources emerge in the midst of that hardship. You begin to feel yourself growing with a greater confidence in the midst of everything that's going on around you. Even with the temptation to turn your back on God, even with the temptation to turn your back on your church family, even with the temptation that comes at times to walk away from it all, through it all, you'll begin to hear the Spirit of God speak to you in a very intimate and in a very unimaginable fashion. And suddenly, after you've already got all the fight out of your system, after you've gotten all the tantrum out of your body, then he will deal with you. He's got you in the timeout room right where he wants you, and he'll let you know now. Just start worshiping. Watch children sometimes when they're at play, and a child is not obeying the instruction of the parent. The parent can only give so many instructions, and after a while, they'll just turn the child loose and just let the child run around and run around and run around and jump up and down and have ice cream fights in the living room and smear the pizza across the walls of the house and start taking the pictures and flipping them across the room like a frisbee. And after about 12 hours of all of this nonsense, after 12 hours of this new interior redecorating, the parent will just watch the child just fall all over, and all of a sudden you might not see them again for 18 hours. They've got all the fight out of their system. They've got all the resistance out of their system. They've got all the play out of their system. They're right where the parent wants them to be, in a place of rest. The parent has them right where they want them to be. Then you don't hear anything else from them until the next day. That is part of the refining process. And it's not a pleasant experience if you've been part of the refining process. But understand something. There are developmental muscles that are being built within you. You're being equipped for a greater fight to come. You're being equipped for a greater testimony to share among the body of believers. There's somebody on the outside that needs to know that God is a deliverance. There's somebody on the outside that needs to know that God is a friend. There's somebody on the outside that needs to know that God is a way maker. There's somebody on the outside that needs to know that God is the truth and the light. They need to know, not because you've fallen, but they need to know because you stood. God is tired of the don't do it this way syndrome. God is tired of the scandal coming to the church to remind people of how they should live right. He wants somebody to just stand in the midst of it all. And if the foundation is right, if no other foundation is laid in your life other than that which is Christ Jesus, then believe me, you will have all of the means, you will have all of the materials, you will have all of the resources, and you will have the foundation necessary no matter what kind of wind beats upon your spiritual house, no matter what kind of rains befall you, no matter what kind of tempest comes your way, you will be able to stand. You might sway a little bit, you might rock back and forth, you might move a little bit off the foundation, but let me tell you something, you just don't slide off the side of the hill, you just kind of ride with it. What do they do? What do they do with skyscrapers that you see all around LA and all around New York and all around Chicago and all around Philadelphia? Chicago's in the house. What do you do with those structures? New Orleans is in the house. What do you do with these different structures? You have to build them what? Not into the existing foundation. You have to build them on a roller and put the roller underneath the foundation. And that way, when the earthquake hits, it will just roll with the debris. They will just roll with the impact. Because if they're built it into the cracking ground, the surrounding environment, it would topple and the destruction would be great. So that's what happens with us. God built us to be able to roll with the impact of adverse natural circumstances. The Bible tells us that in this world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. That's John 14 and 31. So he lets us know, as long as you're living, you're going to have pain. As long as you're living, something is going to happen that is beyond your control. But what he wants you to know is that he is in control. You're only in control when it's self-inflicted pain. If I take a gun, load it up and put it in a four-year-old's hand, and that four-year-old just starts pointing and just starts aiming recklessly, whose fault is it?
Yours.
It's mine. Because I was not equipped, or I did not exercise the wisdom necessary to properly handle my weaponry. And my God, at no other time in history, seemingly, has there been a circumstance, or has there been a series of circumstances befalling the church where so many people can handle the word of God and not know how to handle it and not know how to live by it? And that's why so many different ministries are shutting down right now, because God is tired of it. He's tired of people being turned left and right. He's tired of churches closing because they're not trusting him to keep to give them the finances. They're not trusting him to give them the members. They're not trusting him for the messages. They've heard somebody else preach a message and they'll get up, Sister Greenlaw, and go preach it on. Heard somebody they heard on TV, and because they don't want to put the time in, get on their face before God and go to God and ask God for the word of the hour, they'll end up using what somebody else said, and they'll try to make themselves seem like they're in touch with heaven. To try to justify or to try to conceal their own actions, their own flaws. But the Bible says we have to resist those that do not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, because Jesus Christ came that we might have a life. Jesus Christ came so that we might obtain liberty. Jesus Christ came so that we may obtain friendship with him. And the friendship is not something that he is withholding from anyone. He said, he that is athirst, let him come. He that is a hunger, let him come. And let him have the very best of whatever I have to share with them. He said, peace I leave with you. My peace give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. That's the word of God. That's our guarantee. That he will be with us. But we've got to know what the word of God says if we're going to apply it against the adversary. We can't just use the same scripture over and over. But what we can tell him repeatedly, it is written. And then we've got to know where it's written. We've got to know how to express it. we've got to even know the context of what we're speaking about. I heard people down through the years talk about Paul when he said, I die daily. You know what he was saying on top of the fact that he was laying his life down for God? He was saying that God is going to be glorified in the midst of whatever hardship that comes that puts his life in danger. He was saying that the persecution that comes will cause the church to grow. If you want the church to grow, you're going to have to be willing to go through persecution so that the people of God and the outsiders who don't have a church home and don't have the hope of God within them will look at the life that you're living in spite of your circumstances and say, I want what you have. What you have is allowing you to be able to keep your spiritual bearings. What you have is allowing you to keep your mental faculties. What you have allows you to be at peace, even though there's a circular letter going out to all the workers that you're not going to have a job in 30 days, or you're going to have to relocate yourself in order to have an employment. Letting you know God will give you a peace, you're going to be here. And the other people may be just running all around the office trying to work on resumes, boohooing and crying, and trying to get buyout packages, salary packages, to try to preserve their finances. But God is letting you know that if I'm in control and if you are working for me, let me tell you what he's going to do. In the fourth verse of the third division of the song, he says, and he shall be like a tree planted by the river of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. That's not just spiritual. You can't just run around and speak in tongues and think that you're doing all the work of God. You can't just put your hands together and wait for somebody to cajole you into praising the Lord and think you're doing godly service. You can't just come here and take up an offering plate and think you're working the will of God exclusively. He needs you to be a light on your job. And when you do that, then you will see the favor that Minister Greenlaw spoke about this morning in Sunday school. Then you'll see the favor of God come. Why? Because you're fully submitted to whatever way God takes you. And once you're fully submitted to whatever way God takes you, God is going to look and he's going to see the elements and the elegance of the humility that you have poured out towards him. And it's that humility that's going to move God like nothing else. The time of promotion that comes for you in your life will not be based on work you do exclusively. It's going to be based on whatever God chooses to share with you because he trusts you. He's got to trust you with it. But first of all, he trusts you with him first. And if he can trust you with him, he'll trust you with anything. He's got to trust you with him. And then he will trust you based on your handling of the other things he's blessed you with. So if you're dealing with two or three people you're teaching on a Sunday morning, keep teaching the two or three. If you're dealing with five and six and eight people for YPWW, keep teaching the five, six, and eight. Don't get disturbed, but don't become complacent and figure this is all that God wants me to have, period. Because there is a greater portion that is to come to you based upon your steadfastness. That's what's going to move God. It moved God in the time of Hannah. It moved God in the time of Joseph. It moved God in the time of Miriam. It moved God in the time of David. It moved God in the time of Solomon. Solomon said, I don't want anything natural from you. All I want is to know how to deal with your people. And if I have to know how to deal with your people, I'll know how to walk with excellence before you. God said, because you have not asked for anything, I will give you more than what you ever asked for spiritually. I'll give you more wisdom than anything you've ever asked for spiritually. I'll give you more knowledge. I'll give you more finance. I'll give you more wealth than you ever thought of naturally. I'll give it all to you because you've given all of yourself to me. That was when Solomon was at his peak. And he allowed the enemy, through adversaries to Israel, to blow up on it because God no longer became the top priority. Do you get this? This is why the book of Haggai is so powerful. Because it lets us know, now that we're talking about building the house of God, God is saying, turn all the attention to the house of God. Turn all the attention toward building the kingdom of God. Turn all the attention toward building me a house and building me a center that I can take residence in. And watch me begin to boomerang it upon you spiritually. Watch me begin to boomerang it upon you socially. Watch me begin to boomerang it upon you. You won't even have to network yourself the same way. People will know when they walk into this place that not only am I here, but they will know that this is a place of deliverance, but he's got to come first.
Amen.
It's got to be God. They've got to see God. They've got to feel God. They've got to know that God is here. They've got to know that you have something to offer them. And God says the best thing that you can offer them is just a taste of me. And that comes through oneness. So relationship means two people wanting the same thing. God says when the two work as one, watch how fast he moves on our behalf. The third point is that the blessed is a developed man. The blessed man is one, as David speaks of, who has already developed a relationship with God and is beginning to be moved to a place where God can continue to shuck out those things that prohibit the fullness, the essence of his glory from being seen throughout all of mankind. The people that he wants you to go among, those are the ones that are to be exposed to the greater glory, the greater goodness, the greater rubies, the greater richness of God. Listen, the reason why David can speak here as a worshiper is because a worshiper is an individual who will always allow himself to stay connected through prayer, stay connected through the word, and as they stay connected through the word, they will find themselves becoming more and more thankful for the salvation process that has taken place in their life. They can go back and they can revisit that experience, and each and every individual experience is just that. It's a fragmented experience. You come to know God individually, you come to know God intimately, you come to know God as your own personal Savior, and you reflect back every time you open the Word of God. You reflect back every time you go to pray before God. You reflect back on the times you walk through the house of God. You reflect back every time you hear a song about the Lord Jesus Christ. You reflect back on the time when you knew you were a dirty rat. You reflect back on the time when you knew that you were the kind of person that two or three churches had to pray over you to get saved. You were the kind of person you could cut somebody and laugh at them as they bled to death. You know that you were the kind of individual you could steal the hubcaps off your mother's car and then walk back up to the front door and say, would you like to buy some hubcaps from? And when you know you're that kind of an individual, and you know that God can reach down at a time when you couldn't reach up to him the same way, that's when the experience becomes all new and all revealing, and that's when more and more of the spiritual flesh begins to fall. And you begin to see more and more of yourself, and how more and more of you wants more and more of God throughout the process. You just want more and more of God because you realize it's greater and it's sweeter and it's more compassionate and it's more romancing and it's more complete and it's more thorough. You don't have to look at someone else's life and want it for yourself. All you have to do is be willing to reach up and do the work for it. All you have to do is be willing to say, Father, I want the best that you have for me to have. I want the best of you first. And if you give me the best of you, I know that you'll take care of everything else. He's going to take care of your needs. He's going to take care of the peace of mind that you need at night to sleep. He'll take care of the concerns that you have around your neighborhood. He'll take concern over the people in your life that are unsaved. He'll take care of those individuals who have left home because they don't want to follow instruction. He'll take care of the boss that says that he's going to fire you and there's nothing you can do about it. Let me tell you what favor will do. Favor will hide you in that boss's heart. Even when he walks up into the office that Monday morning and he's already made it up in his mind, he's paperclipped your resume, or he's paperclipped rather your work experience. He's taking your work file. He's taking your work profile. He's calling himself deactivating your key so you can't have entrance into the building. He'll take your identity and he'll say, I want that back when you come in the Monday morning. Bring that with you because we're going to terminate you. And when you're 7:55 Monday morning, you walk into the office and this man has his face turned out like a fist. He's ready to let you go. And before you know it, he's just saying, your workload's over there. Go take care of it. Before you know it, he's called off the assassination. He's called off the unemployment process. He's called off the downsizing process. That's how favor works. When Esther stepped before the king, Esther did not have an idea that God was going to spare. Unless the Bible did not speak what the Lord spoke to her in private, the Bible does not say that she had the guarantee that God would work. It was Mordecai that was the one that spoke to her. Mordecai was the one that let her know, if you say nothing, we may die. And if you do say something, so you might as well just let it rip. Just give him the best of what you have. But what did she do? She went first to God, and she shut herself in. For 3 days, she didn't do anything. For 3 nights, she just sprinkled dust and dung on her head. And she lay before God in the very worst, the sackcloth and ashes. And then after 3 days, she went back. She took her finest tapestry. She took her finest apparel. She perfumed herself. She adorned her hair. She went before the king, and she knew that if the scepter touched her, that was the end of it for her and all of her people. But she went with the peace of God, and that man ended up promoting her. That's how favor works. So the Lord knows the way of the righteous. But then he tells us in the final verse that the way of the ungodly shall perish. I like that word, but, because it lets us know there's a contrast between those who choose to do right and those who predetermine to do the wrong thing. There was a predetermined council who crucified Jesus Christ. No matter what Jesus did at that moment, he could have raised water, he could have turned water into wine once again. He could have taken every blind person throughout all that area, and he could have healed the eyes. Those same people that call themselves worshipers, those same people that call themselves religious, were the very ones that said he was working the work of the devil. Well, if what he's doing is so devilish, how come you're supposed to be such a scribe? How come you're supposed to be so holy? How come you're supposed to be so righteous, and yet you couldn't perform the work? But here comes one among you, no sin, no deceit, no guile down in his mouth, and yet here you are. You're going to sit here and you're going to curse and defame this individual and say he is not real. And you let him know in Matthew 12:31, he said, all manner of sin and blasphemy, wheresoever they shall blaspheme, it will be forgiven man. But he said, he who blasphemes against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world nor in the world to come. Why? Because he said he had an unclean spirit. That's a predetermined mind to do the wrong thing. Proverbs 4:14, once again, a predetermined mind. When you made it up in your mind, you're going to go against anybody who is doing the right thing. Because you're miserable. Because you're wicked. Your feet are swift to shed innocent blood. Romans 3:10 tells us that there's none righteous, no, not one. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Why? Because their mouth is an open sepulcher. You know what a sepulcher is? A sepulcher is somewhere where a person goes to be buried. I've already killed him with my mouth. So now I'm going to continue the process and bury him. I'm going to conclude the process and bury them. But the Bible tells us the way of the ungodly shall perish. Shall. God's going to separate the sheep from the goats. And those that live the life that was independent of the way he wanted them to go, they will be beaten with many stripes. One of the greatest stripes you could ever receive is the frustration of knowing that when God was speaking to your spirit, you did not respond to it. That's one of the greatest stripes you could receive, is to have to live throughout all eternity knowing that every time you turn a blind eye and a deaf ear to a prayer meeting, every time you turn your deaf ear toward a message, any time you laughed at someone who you knew was living right, and you said, yeah, they're a holy roller, it doesn't take all of that, but look, they're comforted and now you're tormented, what are you going to do then? The Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Directions. Directions. He's the way. He's the truth. He's the life. We can't come to him by anybody else. I believe in Hare Hare Krishna, but Hare Hare Krishna didn't save me. I believe in Muhammad. He lived, but Muhammad doesn't live now. I know who Buddha is. But Buddha is just an object. I believe in many things, but I believe that only one person can shed a virgin blood that can save my soul. And that's something that no work and no good-hearted person can do for me. Not one of you can stand before me on Judgment Day and be my advocate. I wish you could. Because Lord knows out of the 50,000 thoughts that go through my head per day and yours, there's about 80% of them that are dishonorable or negative in some way or another, whether or not I am genuine, whether or not I put them into motion. My every thought, my every action is being recorded. So I need the blood of Jesus to cover me. How about you? Let's pray. If you want prayer,